Bokatov, and welcome to Israel. Shalom. I cannot introduce myself better than just heard, but a little bit about myself first. As you have heard, I was born in Israel to a family, and this is a story of Israel. While my father was born in Spanish Morocco and came as a volunteer to fight in the independence war in Israel in 1947. And my mother was born in Egypt to a family that came from Syria and from Turkey. And she left Egypt actually with the support of the Mossad, and they brought her in 52 to Israel. And here I am, was born here. I have four kids. My elder daughter, she was born in Israel. She served in the IDF in the last conflict in Gaza as a combat soldier. She was a commander of observation position in Gaza Strip in Nahal Oz. And my son, my second son, is now in the paratroopers brigade, commanding a squadron in battalion 890. I have a younger daughter. She was born in Paris when I was the Israeli defense attaché there to France, Spain, and Portugal. And I have a young 6 years old son who was born in the U.S. in New Jersey, while I was the Israeli, the national director of the Friends of the Israel Defense Forces. My wife, this is another story of the story of Israel. She was born in Israel. Her name is Ayelet, and she was born to a father that is from Netherlands, from Holland, but was born in Indonesia. As a Christian that was born to a Jewish family and came to Israel, stay as a volunteer in Israel and stay until today here. Her mother was born in London to a family that escaped from Berlin, Germany, just before the Second World War. So actually, you know, generation after generation, one thing we know for sure: this is our home, this is our land, and this where everything starts here in Jerusalem. And that's our future. This is our story. And you know, I don't know if it's you know, if you plan it or not. But 3 days from today, Israel release Jerusalem like in 67, 6 days war from the Jordanian. That hold it for some decades. And now we have Jerusalem, one Jerusalem, and you are welcome here in Jerusalem on those very special days. So I raised in Netanya, in Israel, and when I was almost 14 years old, I have decided together with my parents that I'm going to be to go to a military academy in high school. So yes, 27 years in the IDF, but before I was 4 years high school in a military academy. So I raised to be a soldier, and I continue until today in my military career, even, you know, when I retired from the IDF. So, as a young boy, I face the Yom Kippur war. I faced also the 6 days war, but I was like 16 years old, 17 years old in the Yom Kippur war, when we were in a real, real threat, real, real danger of existence. This is Israel. We are surrounded by enemies, and I think that day after day, we realize who are our enemies, who are our neighbors. And it surprises, I don't know if you, because you know exactly what is Israel about, Christian for Israel, you know very well. But the rest of the world, they really don't know what is Israel about. What is the story of Israel, the story of this holy land, this piece of ground that the history of the world start here, and we are trying to keep it as is. And our neighbors, they have one aim concerning Israel, that Israel won't be here, won't exist, and they will change everything. And they are changing the history, even. Go to Syria and Iraq today. Look what ISIS is doing now. They destroy every piece of history. They're destroying and they want to change the world. If they face a Christian or a Jew, they kill him. But they start with other Muslims. And this is just here, 2 hours from here. Driving from here, 2 hours, not far from here. And this is the threat of today. But not far from there, we have Iran. In a long circle. And Iran, they build a conception, a strategy of how to destroy, how to eliminate Israel from the map. Let me tell you something. It's not just Israel. They say it. They prove it. But by what they do, it's not just Israel. It starts with Israel. But they always, they say that they ever leave America. And the worst. And the proof is that they already have long-range missiles that can cover every square meter in Israel. But they continue to develop much longer-range missiles that can cover all Europe. Why? Why do they need it? I'm talking about military, not producing electricity. Humanitarian electricity. They produce whatever they can do, any capacity of destroying and killing. And they insist of having a nuclear capability. And when you have such a regime who declare that he wants to destroy you, that he wants to eliminate you, once that they have the capability to do it, believe them, they are going to use it. They are going to do it. And from time to time, I have to criticize our alliance, or at least the leadership of our friends in the U.S. How come that you allow them, and not just the U.S., some other countries in Europe. How do you think... Why do they need it? Why do you give them the opportunity to have such a capability? The other neighbors proof already. Every 5 to 10 years we have a war here on this land. They could enjoy such prosperity if they collaborate with Israel, living in peace with Israel, with the West. No, they continue to try to eliminate us. Let me tell you something. They will never succeed. We are very determined. We determined to stay an independent state of Israel here in the Middle East, here in the land of Israel, that historically were giving us, and we will continue to protect it. We will protect the democracy here in Israel. We will continue to be, you know, the door and the protect and the defenders, not just for the Israelis, not just for the Jews all over the world, but for all the free world. All the countries that you came from, believe me, I was in Paris as an Israeli defense attaché. My colleagues from all over the world, when you speak to other generals from any other countries, even the countries that you came, they understand. They understand the threat of our enemies. And they thank us. They thank me for what we are doing because they know that we are on the gate. We, Israel, and the Israel Defense Forces, that's what we do day by day. We risk ourselves. We don't have any other military, any other army who come to fight for us instead of us. Even with all the support that we get, if it's from the US of America, and we get, and from other countries, Germany, etc., no one, no country, no nation, no mother, never send a soldier, her son, to fight here for Israel. We are standing by ourselves, and we will continue to do it, and we have a very determined military. We have a very smart military. We are very few, but very smart. So how do we do it? We are a very small Israel Defense Forces. And so many enemies around us. And not always we have support from the rest of the world. When I was in the U.S., and the second Lebanon War was here, so the media in the U.S. asked me to come and to speak during the war. And I was invited by two main channels, the CNN, of course, and the Fox News. I refused to go to the CNN. I was almost every day in the Fox News because no use to try to explain yourself in the CNN. They will turn everything against you. So, we build our military, the Israel Defense Forces. As I say, a very strong military, but very smart. We develop our ammunition. We initiate whatever is good to find the right solution to the real threat that we have day by day. But the most important means or tools that we have is the people themselves. The people who understand, they come, you know that Israel is a mandatory service, they don't get salary, nothing. When you are 18 years old, you came and you know that this is your time to give for 3 years, and you know that probably during these 3 years you are going to risk yourself sometimes, more than once. And they come with a very high motivation, very good morale, and they join. Mostly they want to join the combat units. And this is, you know, something amazing. When you go to other military, other countries, They pay you to serve in the military. It's a professional military. In Israel, it's a mission. Every young boy and girl, they know that this is their time, their commitment for the state of Israel and for the world. And this military, we have the best people, the best tanks, the best aircraft, even the aircraft that we buy from the US. We add some Israeli technology inside to make it even better. And we develop here in the Israeli military industry the best technology. Can go and can follow every enemy, wherever they are, with the best intelligence that we have on ground and on air, even the space. We are one of the few countries in the world that they have capability in the space, mostly for intelligence and communication. And we have collaboration with other countries on that. They need us. You know, from time to time you think that, you know, all the European countries that are against us, believe me, on the military side, they are with us. They want us. They need us. We give them enough and very good and excellent intelligence, information that they need. Even while they were in Afghanistan, in Iraq, in Africa, in some other places, they need us. We don't, by the Israeli law, we don't join any alliance of war outside of Israel. That's the Israeli law. The Israeli soldiers protect Israel and only Israel. But when the time came and something, a disaster happened anywhere in the world, and you need a humanitarian support, the Israel Defense Forces is the first to go, the first to land. And to support saving of life. We were the first to land in the other side of the globus in Haiti. We land with Israeli Defense Forces aircraft, medical corps, home front command, rescue teams. We land in Haiti, in the Caribbean. We build for them the airport to get other aids and support. And just less than a month ago, we were the first to come to Nepal with the Israeli soldiers, with the Israeli aircraft, with the Israeli teams, soldiers with the Israeli uniform, who serve to protect Israel when we know that somebody else is in trouble and he needs our capability. He needs all the experience. Unfortunately, the experience that we have is experience of, you know, getting missiles, rockets inside and destroying our houses. So while our enemies share their experience of destroying and committed suicide, bombing suicide, etc., we share our experience on saving life. I can tell you that even the organization that I am heading today, Libby, for the security of Israel, we were the first to come and to give our contributions to the team that went to Nepal with medical support, and we bought for them whatever they need. And the soldiers, the rescue teams, the medical teams, they took it with the Israeli aircraft to Nepal, and they left everything there with the hospital field in Nepal. Contribution of Libya. The same we did in Haiti and in, even in Turkey. Turkey that is against Israel today. We were the first to be there when they have the disaster, the earthquake. And we do it with love. We do it because it's written in the Bible. That's what you have to do. If you have an opportunity to save life, go and do it. That's the support that you can. And you know how to fight. Whenever you need to protect the land of Israel, do it. And do it in the best way. Give you an example. How smart is this military? Because it's impossible to describe. How come that you have so many millions of enemies around you? And when they attack you from all the side together, from the north, from the east, from the south, all together. And we are a tiny country with a very small IDF. Still, we succeed. We know. Thank you. And we utilize our technology and imagination how to protect ourselves before they come to attack us. So just imagine when we had a war, let's say with Syria, while the Syrian tanks, they just came out of their bases, you know, like 45 kilometers, 30 miles from the border, we succeed to attack them while they were on the way to the front line. Because we don't have enough soldiers on the front line. So if you have a smart missiles with camera, with lasers and whatever, you heard probably and you read on newspaper or you saw on TV, if you succeed to destroy about 40 to 60% of their capability on their way to the front line, so you understand that when they come to the front line, and especially if you can kill their commander on the way, so they don't have a leadership to fight on the front line. And this is a concept. Go and try to do whatever you can and be smarter than others. Even when Iraq sent their troops through Syria and Jordan to support our enemies on the front line, we blocked them and stopped them like 100 kilometers from Israel, like 60 miles, 60 to 100 miles from Israel. We send our special forces, air force, and some smart units to block them far away from Israel. So you create, you know, a capability that even with a very small military, you can fight and win so many others that are much bigger than you. Now, you think that with this military industry, just to create a strong military that can protect you? No, that's a mistake. When those young boys and girls who came to the IDF and initiate and develop smart things, when they go out from the IDF, when they are 21, 22 years old, they took and they take those ideas, those initiatives with them and develop it for the goods. Develop it to save lives. give you a small example. You know, we find out that if you have a missile that you launch, and it's a stupid missile, once that you launch it, that's it. You have no control. It goes to the target, and if the target move, they are not there. So you waste a missile. What did we do? We develop a very tiny, very microscopic camera that you put it on the head of the missile with, just imagine like you have today the PlayStation, Xbox, all the games that you know your kids are playing, some of you probably also. And this tiny camera has a remote control. You can control them from far away. So you launch this smart missile with a camera, with the capability to control the whole missile and the camera. And you have the intelligence somewhere here, you have an enemy, you have a tank. And you send, you launch the missile. And on the same time, an Israeli soldier, boy or girl, sitting somewhere with their monitor, with their PlayStation, their stick, and they see exactly what the camera is seeing. Now, it's not enough that you have a camera. You want the camera to be friendly, yes? So you ask the camera, please, take a look right, take a look to the left. Maybe we can find a better target. Maybe we can find the commander of the troops. So it's better to go and to attack him. Maybe we can find the tractor, the bulldozer, the one that without him, they cannot open the road. And this young boy or girl in an Israeli uniform is sitting and searching. And once that you find a much important target, you just change controlling the missile, change direction, and go to the new target. And even follow. They can escape, you can follow. Find them and attack them. Okay, so why did I tell you? I don't, you know, tell top secret stories here. The main thing that I want to tell you, that we took those tiny camera with the capability of controlling the camera, we put it in a pill that you swallow. And this pill, the doctor in the hospital can just control and go on your stomach and find the problem that you have and attack it. That came from the Israeli military. And we have so many examples. You know, we were the first to know exactly where all the, you know, chief of terrorism like Arafat and others, where they were every minute, 24/7 we knew. We followed them everywhere in the world. We listened to them. We saw them, everything. And we took all this capability, technology, we turned it, you know, for you, for the people of the world. Every cell phone that you have in the world has an Israeli chip inside that support you and help you. You can follow. Like you have, find my iPhone. You can follow your iPhone or your son or your daughter. You know, they know my kids. I need to know where they are every minute. You know, you can go to a party, you can go to discotheque, whatever. I am your father. I'm going to know exactly where they are. Otherwise, you won't have an iPhone. And I can follow them. I'm not going to go and dance with them, but I need to know. And this is technology, came from the military. So, what are we going to have tomorrow? I'm not here, you know, to disturb you and, you know, to scare you. There is a future. There is a very good future. Because who we are. Because who you are. And, you know, being here in Jerusalem with me, with my soldiers, with the people of Israel, you know, giving me the knowledge and the feeling that I am not alone in this war. We have you. And the challenges in the future, maybe even bigger than what we had in the past. You see what's going on with all the movements, with ISIS, Hamas, Hezbollah, all of them. We are not afraid. We will continue to protect Israel. We will find a solution for each one of them. We will continue to be free. We will continue to be a democracy in this piece of land. With all what's going around us, we will continue to be a Western with an Eastern culture, and very special in Israel. You know, I am coming from the paratroopers. 3 days from today, we are going to celebrate the day that the paratroopers, give freedom to Jerusalem, East and West, all together, United Jerusalem. And it came with those boys and girls that fought and bring us with that victory. And today, the soldiers of today, they continue to do it day by day. So if you ask me, what can you do? First of all, with the fact that you are here in Jerusalem, in Israel, that's first of all, the first step, that your support, and I see it and make me, feeling so good. So I want to thank you so much for being here, supporting us. What we do as an organization, we do whatever is not military, whatever giving the soldiers a feeling, you know, that they are not alone. Some of them came from very needy families. Some of them, you know, came from all over the world to serve as alone soldiers who are alone in Israel, and they need our support. It's not something that the military or the government give them. Or, you know, very simple club, like whoever came from the U.S., they have the USO, and, soldiers need to rest a little bit, to clean their head, you know, coming back from their patrol, from their ambush, from their military operation, and they need, you know, to drink coffee, to watch TV, PlayStation, etc. That's why we need such an organization, that getting support from people like you, medical support, whatever we can do. We will succeed with the support of people like you. So for me, standing here, very determined, very sure, because I know that I have you. Thank you so much, and enjoy your time in Israel. Come again and again. We need you, and we love you. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Good morning. Boker Tov. Bonjour. So what a nice morning here in Jerusalem with you, the city of the future, the city of the past. And you know what? It's a privilege and it's an honor. And I think that we should say, dear brothers, not only dear friends. And thank you for inviting us here. It's an honor for us. Well, I assume for many people, this picture of you, Christian friends, and us, the general and I, to see you standing for the general, it's almost surreal for a part of the world. You know, that's a strange picture. But we should ask together why. Why? We share the same values. We share the same Bible, the same roots. We even share the same heroes. Abraham, Moses, Joshua, King David, all those were warriors here for this holy land, for the land that we love so much. And you know what? Thousands of years after that, we're still making this job, this mission, or the IDF, the soldier of Israel. The IDF is the Israeli defense of Israel. The general said it very good, not only for Jewish in Israel, not only for Israeli in Israel, but for Israel, the center of the world, the center of your world, the center of our world, of our home. So that's still the mission. So I wish I had come today, not on uniform, to tell you about scientific discoveries, technologies, development, or achievement in medical arena. But unfortunately, I don't have this luck. I came to talk about our reality. The reality is to continue to protect our home, my home, your home. We don't have any choice. And as you see, we are very determined to do that and to do it for the best. So that's why I, Eva Cohen, Lieutenant Colonel of the Air Force, I'm originally from France, so I have some brothers here I know. I am a mother of 5 kids, and I decided to be a part of those that choose the protection of Israel as a mission. A mission, you know, it's a daily mission, night and day, and it's a mission of a life. To choose, that you have to do, that you have to assume. But I'm only an example. We are thousands like that, of men, women, young soldiers, father, brothers, that decided to be the protector of this land. And you know what? We are very proud. And we are very proud of it. We are this kind of nation, a nation in uniform. All of us have a friend, a father, a mother in the army. Unfortunately, all of us have lost a friend, a son, a brother. 23,000 of killed in the history, the short history of Israel. 67 years, but so many blood. So many blood here for this land, for the existence of this land. So we have to continue to do that. But we will do it with a smile, with honor, with morality, and we will talk about morality. And we will continue to do that, just for you, for us, and for all the world. Unfortunately, the fighting is not only our only arena. Have you certainly heard the boycott against Israel is amplifying his voices? Why people hate us so much? So they will answer human rights violations. Let me talk to you about morality, okay? Do you know any army in the world that give a phone message before an air attack? Have you ever met this kind of force, even in the Western best army in the world, the moral Western army of the world, of Europe and the United States, in the different mission in Afghanistan and so on? Have you ever heard about a force, a pilot, that is sending a message before an attack? No. Have you ever seen an army that decided to put the life of his soldiers for saving lives of others, for saving lives of innocent people? Let's talk about protective age. Exactly last summer, before 1 year exactly, and Jim just mentioned it, all this operation just started with the kidnapping of our three boys. It was exactly today before 1 year. That's the way it started. And that, what we have in protective age? What we have? We have a choice of IDF to enter into Gaza. You know what some people would say, why? You know, I used to work in the strategic division with all the military attaché abroad. And when you're sitting with those attaché, they are very clear. Why you are not doing the work by air? Why you have to get into Gaza? And you know why? Because we don't want to hurt no more innocent people. We prefer to enter in with ground forces into Gaza, with all soldiers, with them equipment, and trying to fight such a surgical fight, you know, just to touch that, just the terrorism. It's an impossible mission. It's an asymmetric conflict. It's a mission, impossible mission. But Tzal continued to do it. Because he believed that's the way we have to do that. The price was very high. 70 soldiers killed the last operation. So we're talking about morality. We're talking about an army, a system, a country that spends so much money for having surgical operative solutions. You know, for being very precise, not to hurt innocent people. So, morality? Somebody want to take to talk with us about morality? Come on. You know what? From our point of view, it's like a joke. It's just like a joke. You know, we're learning history, and we even learning the different doctrine of the armies in the world today. They are far of being such a moral team. So for all those boycott guys, I say, you want to talk about morality? Come here, like you did, to come to here, to meet the people, to look them into them eyes, to see what you find into those eyes. What you find? You find what we love the most. And you know what is that? Life. Life. Our life, the life of our children, your life, the life of the people in the world. And as the general said, in every place in the world that we will be able to save life, we will be there. In the you mentioned, General, your contribution of the Libby Fund for the team, the delegation to Nepal, $500,000 have been collected by the Libby Fund for this team. But it's not for the team. It's for the population in Nepal, for having a little beginning after this disaster. So that's also those kind of mission that we are doing. So believe me, there is no such an army in the world. There is no such an army in the world. We are different. We have our roots from the Bible. And it has to be on this image of valors, image of loving one each other, image of fighting for peace. Even if it's a little bit paradox, fighting for peace. But in the end of the day, all of us want to have a better future. I wish I could say to my son, you won't go to the army. You don't have to do that. But I know that that's not the case. I know today is 10 years old. I have another one, 8 years old. And I know that I cannot having this promise, unfortunately. And I will look it in my eyes and I will say, I'm sorry that the situation. That's not the future that I've dreamt about for you or I wish for you. But that's your mission. That's your responsibility because it's a mission of life. And we will continue to do that. So that's a few words about morality and boycott. So as the general mentioned, we are the Libby Fund. I lead this organization for 4 years now. This organization, as Jim said, has been founded before 23 years by Menachem Begin. And the very first goal of this initiative was to give a second chance for young boys and girls. We have, which have very, very big difficulties, even a part of them without reading or writing or reading orientations, to give them a possibility into the army, not only to serve, but even to receive knowledge, to receive a second chance, to have the possibility to go back to the Israeli society a better man, to have a better society, to be human for our people. Believe me, there is no army in the world that are doing it. You know? Because the mission is to fight. The mission is tanks, airplanes, ground forces. That's the mission. No, the mission is to see the boys and the girls behind those big machines, to say them, thank you, you gave 3 years, but we want to give you something, maybe knowledge, scholarships, and even a little bit more. And this little bit more from this goal to have a second chance, the Libby Fund does today a little bit more. We are doing in education fields, in saving lives fields, like medical equipment. And even we are a part of the studies for Jewish heritage, you know, to know where you live, to know what is Israel, not only on your eyes, but in the eyes of all over the world. It's very important to understand your mission. Because let's try to understand why a young boy in a very, very developed country, very, very Western country, at the age of 18, will decide to put his life in danger just for the country, just for the borders. Why? It's not so natural. But for him, he is. You know, the last summer reminded that his mission is for the home, with all the rockets around his home. So he understands that it came from there. But you know what? It came from another place. It came only from our past, our dark past. And every young girl and boy in almost every schools on the age of 16, 17, goes to Poland, to the camps, to Auschwitz, to look at our history, to look at our dark history, and to assure, not anymore. Not anymore. With this understanding, our young girl and boys that became soldiers, fighters, warriors, they understand the mission on their shoulders. The mission is bigger than okay, I won't be home this weekend. But it's to assure that not anymore. So that's the reason that very naturally all of us in the age of 18 until 21, for me a little bit more, 20 years, decided to be a part of all of this, the part of all this system. And that's what we want to present it today. We collect close to 25 million shekels every year, $1 million every year, for the soldier, for the welfare of the soldier, for all those fields that I just mentioned. We are very active in the world. We have 8 representations in the world. And, you know, to have the support of the community abroad, the Jewish community around the world, is quite natural. Even it's very kind, it's quite natural. But you have your support is a kind of miracle. Believe me, it's not natural that people like you, friends, brother, decided to help our soldiers. You know, I'm trying to look at this with simply eyes. It's a miracle, and thank you for that. And it means a lot for us, our soldiers. Because as I say, to have the support of mom and dad and the uncle in the United States, it's nice, but it's okay. But you have your support. It changed the way that they will fight here. They know that's not only for us, that's for you too. And you are not standing here and say, yeah, that's the army of Jerusalem, of Israel. You are active. And my dear friend Jim, it's an opportunity to say personally thank you. Thank you, because I don't know if you know, but that's my man here. And we have the chance to work together during years now. And the last year especially, you have been very active, your organization, a lot of donations for our warriors, for our fighters, for the welfare of the fighters, and for this feeling not to be alone, feeling that somebody is here. So it's a great honor, and thank you. Thank you for what you're doing, and I'm really calling you to be good ambassadors for us. That's Tzahal, that's the army of Israel. That's not what you see in CNN. That's something else. And I think, Jim, that maybe for the next conference, it will be good if we had the chance to invite all those people in military base to see the soldiers, to see the missions. I will be the first to arrange it. So I'm inviting you now, all of you, each one of you, to come to our best bases, to our best fields, operational bases. I think that you're more than welcome. It will be, for us, a way to say thank you, a way to show you that's what you have to show, that's what you have to tell. Those are the people that are protecting Israel, protecting Jerusalem. That's the package. No more than that. Those are the boys with those technology. So I came this beautiful morning first just to say thank you. To say thank you for your support, for your love. You know, Libby, it's an abbreviation. Leman Bitachon Israel, for the strengthening of Israel. But Libby, without abbreviation, it's my heart. So in the bottom of my heart, I'm sending you love. And I wish that God will listen to your prayers for us, for you, for all over the world.